Hello, my name is Luke Kelly. I'm the Associate Curator of Collections here at the Utah Museum of Fine Arts.
Hello, I'm Stacy Kelly, and I'm the Director of Collections and the Conservator at the Utah Museum of Fine Arts.
Dr. Shupu Wong, who was putting together a retrospective of Chiura Obata's artistic career, approached the Utah Museum of Fine Arts about hosting the exhibition because of Obata's connection to Topaz internment camp, where he was there from 1942 to 1943. Much of the pieces in the show came from the Obata's family's holdings. And it was through Dr. Shupu Wong that we met the Obata's family, his two granddaughters, Kimmy and Mia Hill. They had indicated to us that after the run of the show had ended, they wanted to disperse the collection to museums across the country. The Utah Museum of Fine Arts was one of the places that they had chosen, not only for us to receive the works that he had composed while at Topaz, but also other works from throughout his artistic career, including this screen from 1932.
Even though Obata now was a celebrated artist throughout the Bay Area, he was always very humble about his talents and very humble about his own art. In 1939, the California Monthly, a UC Berkeley magazine, worked with Obata, commissioning him to do a series of covers for the magazine. He had also made a series of paintings of the campus, which turned into a book and was sold to the university. For this project, the university sent out a photographer to visit Obata in his studio. But it's within the studio photo we can see he may have had a favorite piece of art, because in the background of the photo is the horse's screen. Now, Obata may have exhibited this piece only once during his lifetime, but it was probably something more near and dear to his heart.
This screen was not included in the 2018 retrospective of Obata's works. And it was really unfortunate, but the reason why was that it was completely split down the middle and separated into two pieces. Much of the work was also stained and discolored. You could see the degradation coming through from the wooden core lattice into the front-facing painting paper. There were also some punctures and some other tears and spot staining and things like that.
There are a few conservators in the United States who specialize in Asian art conservation, and even less who accept work from private sources. When we were thinking about applying to this grant, the first person who came to mind was Nishio Conservation Studio in Washington, D.C. Yoshi Nishio and his team came highly recommended from other institutions, and he was obviously the best person to take care of Obata's screen.
It's really important to not think about the conservation of Asian artworks in the same way that we think of the conservation of Western artworks. When screens like these folding screens in Japan were created, same as hanging scrolls, the expectation was that they were essentially part of the furniture in the household. And these works would actually undergo multiple series of remounting based on just wear and tear and use. So when the screen was sent to Nishio Conservation Studios for treatment, the expectation is that the screen would be opened up, the paintings will be removed, essentially the first layer of paper on the front will be taken off, and then it would be remounted on layers of paper, lined layer by layer. And when you think about a screen, you're not thinking of a flat object, you're thinking about a very much three-dimensional object with many, many, many layers of paper between the very front-facing painting all the way to the center wooden lattice of the screen, and then a bunch of papers again, and then you have the backing of the screen. So what happened was that they took the paintings out of the screen, lifted off the backing layer, discovered these amazing drawings and the full-scale preparatory drawings. And they had to do that so that they could take the painting off, do the necessary treatments, and then remount it onto a new screen. The treatment also included washing to remove the discoloration that had been created from the acidic wooden lattice inside the screen, some consolidation of the media so that the media would not bleed when it was undergoing washing, and of course some light bleaching to reduce some of that spot staining that was there and bring out more contrast in the background. And then, of course, the screen was then remounted with layers of lined paper that are Japanese paper that would age extremely well with a new internal Japanese cedar lattice that also will cause less deterioration, less discoloration over time.
Luke, our curator, Adelaide, our head photographer, and I traveled to Washington, D.C. in October of 2022 to see the progress on the screen conservation. We met Yoshi and his amazing team and discussed the next steps in treatment regarding the incredible discoveries.
And you said that Obata makes...
Yeah, Obata made all his own, besides growing his own sumi, he also made all his own pigments, minerals from, you know, local, you know, whenever he did color.
Okay.
Color, so.
So he used Japanese traditional techniques.
Yep.
So
yes.
He used the ink sticks.
Yes.
He brought from Japan.
Yeah.
Or bought in California.
Yeah.
From China.
I would say this was painted flat, because no one would take a risk with this, such watery things.
Yeah.
And paint and dripping.
Okay.
If you drip it, that's the end of it. You can never. So they don't want to take chance.
Mm-hmm.
So this was painted on the floor, yeah, with the bridges to go across or lie down or something.
So was it a surprise when you had it on its front and you found the drawing like right when you took off the
the
backing?
The front side and back side have those.
So now I can see the joints.
Practicing. This is an orchid.
And I love to see how he changed the positioning of the leg and over there, like the hoof as well.
Yeah.
I think it's truly a treasure to be able to see it side by side.
Oh, yes.
He changed the whole position.
So if Obata had created the screen in Japan, the story would have ended. It would have gone to Nishio Conservation Studios. He would have removed the layers, rebuilt up, and carried out the work on it. It would have been ready for exhibition. Except he was in America. He did not have access to the same source material Japanese screen makers did. So he had to make do with what he had. And what he had access to was his own work. And so this was the exciting discovery, that literally his heart and soul was beneath the layers. Practice works that he had given at gallery demonstrations in the 1930s, his summer class at UC Berkeley, which led him to have a second career as an art history professor, and most importantly, the preparatory drawing of the horses itself, which from a artistic and curatorial standpoint is like the find of the century. So I used to joke with the Hill family that they didn't give us one work, they gave us more than 100.
I think it's also really exciting to think about, you know, how Obata was able to use what he had available to him. And what that meant was, you know, in Japan, screen makers would go to these recycling paper stores where accounting firms or businesses would just send off their accounting ledgers that they had already finished using and give it to these recycling stores. And then screen makers would go there and purchase these essentially like secondhand paper. And those pages would then be glued together very skillfully into almost like long rolls of paper. And those rolls were what formed these layers inside the screen, like row by row of paper that forms each section, and multiple layers of those. And Obata didn't have these paper recycling stores, and so what he did was he made those rolls with his own practice drawings from his own demonstrations and from his students' work to form up those layers.
So many of the practice works that were within the layers came from a summer class that he was invited to teach at UC Berkeley in 1932. And he did not just give theory, he gave actual demonstrations of brush techniques, of how to do shapes. And this is a wonderful discovery and finding that we have. So with this fabulous discovery of the preparatory drawing of the practice works, we were able to reach out to Bank of America with this exciting news, which them being so generous, gave us a second grant, which allowed us to create a second screen of the preparatory drawing, as well as taking apart the many layers of his drawings to create separate artworks for each one of them.
We were able to examine the screen in both the ultraviolet spectrum and also the infrared spectrum. And these things reveal different, basically just different behaviors of what's going on in the painting. So for instance, when we look at it in visible light with our eyes, you can see, you know, what colors he used. You can see how he moved his brushes across the paper. But when we look at it in infrared, what we found was that looking very closely, we couldn't find any signs of an underdrawing that Obata might have used to sort of trace out his final composition. He essentially executed this entire painting freehand, just from his innate like ability as an artist, his many, many years of training in the Japanese tradition, and his experience as an artist. And that is how we get this final image.
All of us at the UMFA are incredibly grateful to the Bank of America for funding the conservation of Obata's screen and the additional artworks discovered during the process. We also want to thank the UMFA's and Kate Stewart Docent Conservation Fund for supporting many aspects of our exhibition and our ability to photograph and analyze the screen and the rest of the works. And finally, big thanks to Nishio Conservation Studios, Yoshi and his amazing team, whose impeccable conservation work allows us to share the original horse's screen, its new companion screen, and the many drawings found with our community.